Justice Department's Anti-Terrorism Advisory Council and the U.S. Intelligence Community. He has discussed jihad, Islam, and terrorism at a workshop sponsored by the U.S. State Department and German Foreign Ministry. He is a consultant for the Center for Security Policy and the Vice President of the American Dream Defense Initiative. Spencer is a weekly columnist for PJ Media and Front Page Magazine and has written hundreds of articles about jihad and Islamic terrorism. His articles on Islam and other topics appeared in the Los Angeles Times, the San Francisco Examiner, the New York Post, the Washington Times, the Dallas Morning News, Fox News Opinion, National Review, The Hill, the Detroit News, Townhall.com, Real Clear Religion, The Daily Caller, The New Criterion, The Journal of International Security Affairs, the UK's Guardian, Canada's National Post, Middle East Quarterly, WorldNet Daily, First Things, Inside in the News, and many other journals. For nearly 10 years, Spencer wrote the weekly Jihad Watch column at Freeman Events. He also served as a contributing writer to the Investigative Project on Terrorism and as an adjunct fellow for the Free Congress Foundation. Spencer has appeared on a huge number of news outlets, just a few, including the BBC, ABC News, CNN, Fox News' The O'Reilly Factor, Megyn Kelly's The Kelly File, The Sean Hannity Show, PBS, MSNBC, CNBC, C-SPAN, CTV News, France 24, Voice of Russia, Croatia National Television, and many others. We are thrilled to have him here with us tonight, so it is my honor to welcome Robert Spencer.
Thank you. I'm very honored to be here. And I want to thank especially the College Republicans for braving all the opprobrium and bringing such a villainous character as I to the campus this evening. And I am grateful for all the people who are here to have a civil discussion. It is very difficult nowadays to have a civil discussion. And a lot of people think that I ought not to have been afforded this platform to have a discussion about these issues, because they have claimed, I have seen in the last week or so, that I do not make the necessary distinction between Muslims and terrorists and supposedly demonize all Muslims in a way that endangers innocent people. Now, this is a false charge, but actually something quite like it is really going on. What's actually going on is that there is a conflation, a distinction that is not being made, not between Muslims and terrorists. The distinction that is not being made is between legitimate criticism of and analysis of the motivating ideology of jihad terrorists and those people who are actually genuinely racists and bigots. And any analysis of that motivating ideology of the jihad terrorists is all too often consigned to the realms of racism and bigotry in a way that is actively deleterious to the ability of free nations and free individuals to oppose and resist that terrorism. I'll give you a case in point. About 10 years ago, there was a jihad plot at Fort Dix in New Jersey. And there was a group of Muslims who were going to go into Fort Dix and shoot up the place, kill as many American soldiers as possible before they themselves would be killed. The plot, however, was foiled. And it was foiled in a very interesting way. It turns out that these jihadis, they were, after all, jihadis. And as jihadis themselves often remind us, they love death. They love death. They have often said, Jokhar Tsarnaev, one of the Boston Marathon bombers, and many others have said, we will win because we love death more than you love life. So, these jihadis, they loved death, and they loved to watch death videos, beheading videos, war videos, all sorts of bloodshed and gore. But the problem was, this was 10 years ago, more than that now, they had them on VHS tapes. And so, they went to a video store in Jersey and asked the guy to transfer their VHS tapes of jihad bloodshed to DVD. And I don't know, I never worked in a video store, I don't know how it works, but apparently he had to watch this young man, 17 years old, he had to watch the videos in order, in the process of transferring them. And he was very disturbed by what he saw. Yet 17-year-old young man named Brian Morgenstern and he went to his boss, and he said, "Dude, I'm seeing some very disturbing shit on these videos. Should I call the police, or would that be racist? Should I call the police, or would that be racist?" Now, I should note at this point that the jihadis in question were Albanian Muslims from Kosovo who were all white guys. They were white Europeans. And yet he had internalized to such a degree the idea that even resistance to people who were going to commit mass murder, resistance, opposition to trying to thwart people who were going to try to kill as many human beings as they possibly could, that somehow that would be wrong, that somehow that would be racist. And so he almost didn't do it. We can all be grateful that he decided to go ahead and be racist and to brave the opprobrium that he thought might come to him for reporting these men. Now, this was the result. Where did he get this idea? He got this idea from day after day, week after week, year after year, being told that if you talk about how jihadis use the texts and the teachings of Islam to justify violence and to make recruits among peaceful Muslims, then you are part of the problem. You are part of the Islamophobia industry that is creating fear and hatred of Muslims. When in reality, if there is any unjustified suspicion of Islam among any non-Muslims, Americans or non-Americans, then it is the result of terrorist attacks. I mean, I appreciate the tribute that the previous speaker gave to me in contributing to me such power that I would be able to manipulate the American people into fearing and hating Muslims. But I ain't that good. It was not I who did this. If anybody fears and hates Muslims, that's unfortunate. But the people who are responsible are Nidal Malik Hassan, the Fort Hood Jihad Massacre shooter, Jokar and Tamerlan Tsarnaev, the Boston Marathon bombers, Tashfeen Malik and Syed Rizwan Farooq, who killed 15 people at a Christmas party in San Bernardino in December 2015, Mohammed Abdulaziz, who killed four Marines in Chattanooga, and so many others. People see what's happening, and they don't understand why it's happening, in particular because they are told that if they take what the jihadis say and listen to them, and they hear them crying Allahu Akbar, and they hear them quoting the Quran and repeating what it says as a justification for their acts, then there's something wrong with them. Then they're racist and evil and bigoted. And no doubt making millions in the process. I found out tonight that I'm a millionaire. That's very interesting. But unfortunately, none of that is true. And all these things are based on distortions and half-truths that have intimidated and manipulated all too many people into thinking that it's a terrible thing to stand up against mass murder and oppression and religiously sanctioned violence. Now, obviously, not all Muslims believe this. This is absolutely true. It was claimed in this previous talk that the understanding of Islam that I'm going to give you is the same as the understanding of Islam that Osama bin Laden would give you were he here tonight, or Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the caliph of the Islamic State, who it was claimed had no religious training. Actually, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi has a PhD in Islamic studies from the University of Baghdad. Actually, I'd like to set your minds at ease about that. I'm not going to give you my understanding of Islam at all. My understanding of Islam is completely unimportant and irrelevant. The understanding of Islam that every person of goodwill who opposes terrorism, Muslim or non-Muslim, the understanding of Islam that every such person needs to be concerned about is the understanding of Islam that the jihad terrorists are indeed spreading. And it is unfortunately not their own invention. I have here several authorities. One of them is a Quran, I got this in London in 2009. You may have heard Mr. Syed say that I'm not allowed to go into Britain, and that's quite true. But he was actually quite wrong in saying that I was barred from Britain for being an extremist. I do have an extreme love for certain kinds of foods, but that's about it. There was no mention in the letter. I was sitting in my office one day, and FedEx came up, and they gave me this certified letter, and I had to sign for it, and even the FedEx guy was impressed. He said, it's from the British government. And the British government wrote to me, and they said, don't come. We won't let you in. And this is why they said it. They said, because you said Islam has a doctrine and theology and legal system mandating warfare against unbelievers, therefore you are not allowed to come in. The same week that they barred me from Britain for saying that Islam has a doctrine of warfare against unbelievers, they let in Muhammad al-Arifi, who is a Saudi sheikh, who has said that jihad involves the smashing of the skulls and the spilling of the blood of the infidels. Clearly, Muhammad al-Arifi believes that Islam has a doctrine of warfare against unbelievers. But that was okay with the British government. It was not okay with the British government for me to say it. The difference is, apparently, you can get into Britain if you're for it, but not if you're against it. Of course, the British government has to deal with the very large and increasingly restive Muslim population, and so one might understand why that is so, but I digress. In 2009, before the ban, I went to London, and I was there on business, but I had some free time, and so I did what any tourist in London would do, any American tourist, I toured the local mosques. And so I went to the Finsbury Park Mosque in London, which was the mosque of Abu Hamza al-Masri, who was, you may have seen pictures of him, he's a very fearsome looking character. He was making a bomb once, and he blew off his hands and put out one of his eyes. And so he has two hooks for hands, and one of his eyes has no pupil. And he was the imam at the Finsbury Park Mosque, but he was ultimately removed from there and imprisoned for various jihad plotting. He was trying to establish an Al-Qaeda training camp in Oregon, and so he's now in prison in the United States. But the Finsbury Park Mosque remains. I went there in 09 after he was gone, and I said to the very kind young man who was there, and he was weighing me down with books, he gave me a lot of wonderful books, including this edition of the Quran, and I said, I understand there was a little bit of trouble here a few years back. And he said, yes, there were some extremists here, but now they're all gone and we're all moderates. And so he gave me this moderate Quran. This Quran is very useful because it has commentary by Sayyid Abu Ala Maududi, who was a Pakistani Islamic scholar and politician. He's the founder of Jamaat Islami, which is still the largest Islamist political party in Pakistan. He also wrote a multi-volume commentary on the Quran. And I know that the Muslims here can attest, if you go to any Islamic bookstore, brick and mortar or online, you will find Maududi's writings, including his commentary on the Quran. In other words, he's not considered an extremist, he's very mainstream. And so let's take Maududi, for example, on chapter 9, verse 29. Chapter 9, verse 29 of the Quran says, fight those who do not obey Allah and his messenger, and do not forbid what he has forbidden, even if they are of the people of the book, which is primarily Jews and Christians, until they pay the jizya, which is a tax, with willing submission and feel themselves subdued. Now, you don't have to pay any attention to what I think about that passage. Let's go to Maududi. Maududi says, the purpose for which the Muslims are required to fight, is not, as one might think, to compel the unbelievers into embracing Islam. Okay, so the fighting is not about forced conversion. Very good. But what is it for? Rather, its purpose is to put an end to the suzerainty, the rule, of the unbelievers, so that the latter, the unbelievers, are unable to rule over people. Did you get that? I'll repeat that. Its purpose is to put an end to the suzerainty of the unbelievers, so that the latter are unable to rule over people. Not just some people, not just the people who have stolen land or oppressed the Muslims or something of that kind, but it's an open-ended thing. Unbelievers are not to be invested with political power. He goes on to say the authority to rule should only be vested in those who follow the true faith. Unbelievers who do not follow this true faith should live in a state of subordination. Anybody who becomes convinced of the truth of Islam may accept the faith of his or her own volition. The unbelievers are required to pay the jizya, the poll tax, in return for the security provided to them as the dhimmis, the protected people of the Islamic State. Jizya symbolizes the submission of the unbelievers to the suzerainty of Islam. So in other words, there's no idea of equality of rights for all. But this is a very clear hierarchy where the Muslims rule and the non-Muslims submit and pay this tax and show that they are in subordination to the Muslims. And Maududi is saying that that is the purpose for which the Muslims are required to fight. Now, obviously, he's not the only Islamic scholar, and there are many, many other voices that say many, many other things. The problem here is the people who do believe him and the people who do agree with him. Because once again, he is not some kind of extremist. He was not a member of a terrorist group. He did not pick up a gun and shoot people. He was a politician and an Islamic scholar. Mr. Syed noted, he made a great deal of the fact that there are Christians in Egypt. They're not actually Catholics, they're Coptic Orthodox. But in any case, the Coptic Orthodox churches that were bombed the other day do indicate that there have been Christians in Egypt from the 7th century, the time that the Muslims conquered Egypt, up until today. So that's very impressive. Mr. Syed would have us believe that that means that Islam is tolerant and does not mandate the conquest of the unbelievers, or presumably all those Christians would be gone. Let's look at that in historical perspective. Egypt, when it was conquered in the early 640s, late 630s, early 640s, by the Arab armies, it was 99% Christian. Today, it is between 6 to 10% Christian. Where did all those Christians go? Did they leave? Some did, but most of them stayed. It wasn't so easy, up until modern times, to be mobile, to move halfway across the world, whatever. The Christians of Egypt are still there. They're the Muslims. Did they convert because of the compelling nature of the message of Islam that they saw to be superior to that of Christianity? Obviously, some of them must have. At the same time, the Christians had to pay a crushing tax, this jizya. Some of the early records have some of the Christian families having to sell their children to get the money to pay this tax. And they had to live with various humiliating and discriminatory regulations, which still remain part of Islamic law, Sharia, or Sharia, as Mr. Syed likes to call it. One of them was that they can't build new houses of worship or repair old ones. And so that means, obviously, your community is always in a state of decline. There have been some riots and some very, very unpleasant situations in Egypt quite recently because Christians were trying to build a church. And the Muslims there consider this is against Islamic law. The Christians are not allowed to build a church. And so they have to be forcibly stopped from doing so. And they were. They cannot hold authority over Muslims, so they can only hold the most menial jobs in society. At every turn, they have to, for example, like in the old Jim Crow South, they have to step off the sidewalk if a Muslim is coming. They have to be always reminded of their subordinate state. But there was one way you could get out of this, just like that, and be treated like everybody else, and that was to convert to Islam. Over the 14 centuries intervening, most of the Christians did indeed do that. It's just human nature. However much they may have valued the Christian faith, at the same time, it's miserable to live under those laws. Now you might say, well, you're extrapolating. These are laws that came about because of various political or historical circumstances that actually have nothing to do with Islamic law. So I brought another book so that you wouldn't have to believe such a villainous fellow as I. You can believe Al-Azhar. Al-Azhar in Cairo is the foremost institution in Sunni Islam. Islam has no central authority, no pope, but the closest thing to it in terms of influence and prestige is Al-Azhar. Barack Obama, when he gave his outreach speech to the Islamic world on June 4th, 2009, he spoke at Al-Azhar in Cairo, and he praised it as a bastion of learning and of intellectual exploration for over 1,000 years. This is a manual of Islamic law. It's a very handy one-volume manual of Islamic law, and it carries in the beginning of it a certification from Al-Azhar. And the certification says that this, we certify that the above-mentioned translation, obviously I'm reading this in English, we are speaking English tonight, the above-mentioned translation corresponds to the Arabic original, that's one, and conforms to the practice and faith of the Orthodox Sunni community. Sunnis are 85% roughly of Muslims worldwide, and the Al-Azhar, the foremost institution in Sunni Islam, is saying that this book conforms to the practice and faith of the Orthodox Sunni community. In other words, you want to know what Sunni Islam is all about, it's in this book. It also carries certifications, endorsements from the Mufti of the Jordanian Armed Forces, the International Institute of Islamic Thought, which is a prominent organization in the United States as well as worldwide, and actually came up with the whole idea of Islamophobia. Islamophobia was coined, it's the word that's been used here and there since the beginning of the 20th century, but it was chosen at a meeting of the International Institute of Islamic Thought as being something that would be intentionally used to intimidate people into thinking there was something wrong with resisting jihad terror. And the problem is, here again, important distinctions are not made. There are attacks against innocent people, and like the burning down of the mosque in Joplin and so on, well, that's reprehensible, and there's no excuse for that, and no sane person would justify it. And if that's Islamophobia, then obviously everybody's against it. But also under the rubric of Islamophobia, as I pointed out earlier, is the attempts to understand the motives and the goals of the jihad terrorists so that they can be resisted more effectively. So anyway, this book, certified by some of the highest authorities in Sunni Islam, including Al-Azhar, and this is what it says. It says, jihad means to war against non-Muslims. Jihad means to war against non-Muslims. It does go on to say that that's the lesser jihad. The lesser jihad is warfare, and the greater jihad, as Mr. Syed pointed out, is the spiritual struggle within the soul to become a better person. This manual of Islamic law dismisses that greater jihad in that single paragraph, and then goes on for about 10 pages giving rules about the lesser jihad. Quoting the Quran, saying, fighting is prescribed for you, that's Surah 2, verse 216, kill them wherever you find them, Surah 4, verse 89, that's also in 2191 that he put up, and also chapter 9, verse 5, the verse of the sword. Fight the idolaters utterly, chapter 9, verse 36. It then quotes some hadiths. Hadiths are reports about Muhammad's words and deeds. When considered authentic by Islamic scholars, then they're normative for Islamic law. So obviously these are authentic hadiths, or they would not be certified by Al-Azhar. Muhammad says, I have been commanded to fight people until they testify that there is no God but Allah, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and perform the prayer and pay zakat. If they say it, they have saved their blood and possessions from me, except for the rights of Islam over them. So if they say there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his messenger, their blood and possessions are safe. Therefore, if they don't say it, their blood and possessions are not safe. Goes on quoting more hadiths, and it says that the caliph makes war upon Jews, Christians, and Zoroastrians, provided he has first invited them to enter Islam in faith and practice, and if they will not, then invited them to enter the social order of Islam by paying the non-Muslim full tax jizya, which is the significance of their paying it, And the war continues until they become Muslim or else pay the non-Muslim poll tax. And then it quotes chapter 9, verse 29, which I quoted to you earlier. It goes on to say that once the war has been successfully completed and the non-Muslims have been defeated, then they take on the status of the dhimmis, the protected people. Now, protected people is the name, but you have to understand what that protection is like. You may recall stories about the mafia, and the mafia would go to a storefront, and they would go in and see the storekeeper, and they would say, "You've got a very nice place here. This beautiful little store you got here, you know, it'd be a shame if a rock came through that window. I can make sure that doesn't happen for you if you pay me $100 a week." That's protection. You pay protection, you don't get victimized. The same thing here. The minimum non-Muslim poll tax is one dinar, that is 4.235 grams of gold per person, and so on. And then the non-Muslims are distinguished from Muslims in dress, and the reason for that comes in the next provision. They are not greeted with Assalamu alaikum, peace be upon you. They are greeted with the greeting, peace be upon those who are rightly guided, that is, the Muslims. They must keep to the side of the street. They may not build higher or as high than the Muslims' buildings. And they are forbidden to openly display wine or pork, to ring church bells, or display crosses, recite the Torah or gospel aloud, or make public display of their funerals and feast days, and are forbidden to build new churches. If they violate these agreements in any way, then their lives are forfeit. Or if they insult Islam or Muhammad, then their lives are forfeit. So these things are part of classic traditional Islamic law from mainstream sources. They are not the twisted, hijacked understanding of Islam that vicious Islamophobes like Spencer are trying to pass off as the real thing. You gotta wonder about a motive there, since there really isn't a whole lot of money in this, and there's a great deal of risk. Mr. Syed praised the police, but the police are here because I was threatened. The police are here because it was out on Twitter, bash the fash, because of course it's fascist to oppose jihad mass murder. And the police are here because people were saying, punch Spencer's face. They were not here for Mr. Syed's protection, although I am very glad that they were here in case that there was any rogue Islamophobe who might have dared to accost him, that they were here for his protection as well. But the reality is that this is a concerted effort to demonize and stigmatize, marginalize, and thereby silence anybody who speaks honestly about the nature, the sources, and the derivation of Islamic terrorism, with the obvious object of clearing away obstacles to Islamic terrorism so that it can advance unimpeded and unopposed. Brian Morgenstern, the young man in New Jersey, was afraid that if he turned in the jihad killers, he would be a racist. And there are many, many other people who feel the same way. Syed Rizwan Farouk and Kashfi Malik, the San Bernardino shooters, after they killed all those people at the Christmas party, their neighbors said, well, you know, they were acting very suspiciously. And there were people coming and going all night, and we thought that something wrong was going on there. And the obvious question followed, did you call the police? No. Why didn't you call the police? Well, we didn't want to appear to be racist or xenophobic. And this is the kind of number that's been done on anyone who has an honest analysis of this. Now, what is the background of that initiative? Mr. Syed noted that very proudly that he is a representative of the Council on American-Islamic Relations. The Council on American-Islamic Relations, he said, is a big target of right-wing extremists who say that it sucks lemons. Actually, as a foremost person accused of being a right-wing extremist, I can tell you that I've never said that care sucks. never said, I hate CARE, or any of this nonsense. The reality is that I oppose CARE because CARE CARE is a front group for Hamas. And Hamas is a terror group that actually celebrates the murders of civilians in Israel and elsewhere. And I see people, yes, it's terrible, it's ludicrous to say that CARE is a front group for Hamas, except it was established by the Justice Department of the United States. The Justice Department of the United States noted that Omar Ahmed and Nihad Awad were the co-founders of CARE. They came from the Islamic Association for Palestine, which was closed down for being a front group for Hamas. And that there was an investigation of CARE going on in 2009 that was quashed by the Obama administration for reasons it has never disclosed. But there's quite a bit more. Nihad Awad, the co-founder of CARE, he has on record saying, I am in support of the Hamas movement. He said that at Barry University. And Omar Ahmed, his co-founder, in 1998, he said at a speech in California that the Quran, Muslims are not in the United States to coexist with other religions. Muslims are in the United States to become dominant and make the Quran the only law of the land. He was speaking to a group of Muslims. He didn't know that there was a reporter there, a non-Muslim reporter. She was not an Islamophobe. She was not a right-wing extremist. She was just a reporter for the local paper, Lisa Gardner of the Fremont Argus. And she reported what he said, and nothing happened. About 5-6 years later, somebody noticed, I think it was Daniel Pipes or somebody noticed, that Ahmed had said this and began to publicize it. And it was only then that Omar Ahmed said, I never said that. And Lisa Gardner of the Fremont Argus was found, and she said, I heard him say it. I stand by the story. She did not have any racist or Islamophobic ulterior motive. She was simply reporting what she had heard. She was not informed about these matters, was not an ideologue, was not an activist. She was just a reporter. In 2007, the Holy Land Foundation was raided. The Holy Land Foundation was, at that time, the largest Islamic charity in the United States. After a trial, it was shut down for funneling charitable contributions to Hamas. At the time that it was put on trial, at the time that it began to be put under investigation, the FBI raided the offices of the Holy Land Foundation. They carted away all these documents. One of the documents was entitled The Strategic Goal for the Muslim Brotherhood in the United States. And it was written by Muhammad Akram, who was indeed a very high up Muslim Brotherhood leader. And it said that the brothers must understand, and I quote, that their work in America is a kind of grand jihad in eliminating and destroying Western civilization from within and sabotaging its miserable house by their hands and the hands of the believers. See, sabotaging the miserable house of the West by their own hands, getting non-Muslims in the West to help sabotage their own house. Eliminating and destroying Western civilization from within and sabotaging its miserable house by their hands and the hands of the believers so that it falls and Allah's religion is victorious over other religions. I didn't write that. That was from this Muslim Brotherhood document that was found in the Holy Land Foundation raids. The Holy Land Foundation document, the Muslim Brotherhood document rather, also contained a list of allied Muslim Brotherhood organizations, including the Islamic Society of North America, the Muslim Students Association, the Muslim American Society, the International Institute of Islamic Thought that certified that book, and the Islamic Association for Palestine, from which comes CARE. And so you have a number of indications that it might be the motives of these people who are telling you these things, and they sound so good, and the presentation is very slick, and it all sounds so entertaining, the motive might be something quite different. Now, it may be. CARE, of course, denies all this, but as I say, it was certified by the Justice Department as an unindicted co-conspirator in the Holy Land Trial Foundation case. and the Holy Land Foundation was funneling money to Hamas. At least the question needs to be raised. What is exactly the imperative here? CARE has opposed virtually every counterterror measure that has been implemented, including a perfectly legal surveillance project that is certified by several judges as being completely constitutional in New York City, in various other places as well. There have been perfectly reasonable programs shut down on the grounds that they're supposedly racist and bigoted. Now, certainly there are Muslims who oppose jihad terror. Certainly there are Muslims who are not in line with this program. But when you have a group with multiple ties to a terrorist organization, when you have a group that has obstructed counter-terror efforts in numerous ways, I had a friend went to CARE's conference in Florida, in Tampa, and sent me some photos of some of the brochures that were out on the table. And they were what to do when the FBI comes. And it was a picture of the shh symbol. And of course, in CARE San Francisco, they distributed posters saying, don't talk to the FBI. So when you talk about, you know, what do you expect us to do? Well, I do expect cooperation with law enforcement efforts, yeah, and not counsel to people not to cooperate with law enforcement efforts. And when you have that kind of thing, then you gotta wonder what's going on here. And there's more. What else? What do you expect us to do? I'll give you an idea. How about this? There is a worldwide problem. It's been completely obscured by these bogus charges of racism and Islamophobia and so on, but there is a worldwide problem. 30,000 plus jihad terror attacks resulting in fatalities around the world since 9/11. That's a massive problem. Same number, as a matter of fact, 30,000 young Muslims from around the world, from 100 countries, went to Iraq and Syria to join ISIS because they believed in its claims to be the caliphate, the sole legitimate government for Sunni Muslims. Now, 30,000 people somehow got it all wrong, and many of them were Americans. There has been a big problem in the Minneapolis-St. Paul area of young Muslims first going back to Somalia, where many of them were from, to join Al-Shabaab, the jihad terror group, and then later, when ISIS was formed, going to Iraq and Syria to join the Islamic State. It is a huge problem that Minneapolis officials have tried to address in various ways. But there's one glaring omission, and that is that there's not a single mosque in the Minneapolis area or anywhere else that has any kind of program to teach young Muslims why they should reject the understanding of Islam offered by Al-Qaeda, ISIS, Al-Shabaab, and so on. Now, this is a very strange omission again. You want to know what we can do? Well, why don't we start some classes and say, this is all wrong. It's very easy to come to a university and tell a lot of non-Muslims that Islam doesn't really stand for all that, but it's not going to prevent the next terror attack. What needs to be done is to go to the Muslims who believe in this understanding of Islam. And if you're sincere about opposing it, and sincere about saying that it's not actually the correct interpretation of Islam, then give them a different understanding and teach them why it's wrong. But that we don't see happening. Why not? What is it that is really going on here? In all the demonization of me and other people that I work with, and all the lies that are told about us, and all the false claims that are made about us, what is the point? What is the end game? These comparisons with the way that the Catholics and Jews were mistreated in the United States of the past omits several important factors. One was, there was not an international organization of Catholics or Jews boasting about how they were going to sow mayhem and calling upon believers in the United States to kill innocent civilians. There was not an organization of Catholics or Jews within the country that was obstructing efforts to stop those people. There was not an organization in the United States that was attached to a Catholic or Jewish terrorist group outside the country. So here we again come back to where I began. If there is any Islamophobia, understand me what I mean. Obviously, there are sometimes attacks on innocent Muslims, and that is always to be rejected and always to be opposed. But if by Islamophobia is meant a reading of the texts that I read to you tonight and many, many others like them, and an attempt to understand what motivates and what is the goal of the terrorists so that we can resist them more effectively, what is the end game of foreclosing on that and saying that it's all racist, it's all hateful, it's all bigoted, it's all just like anti-Catholicism and know-nothingism of the 1850s? What's the point? If I am no longer allowed to speak anywhere, which is pretty much nearly the case now, and if I'm banned from every country in the world, and if all the wicked people like me go away, what happens? Will the jihad stop? It will not. Will the texts that motivate the jihad go away? They will not. What will happen? If all of you came to hear hate speech so that you could go away feeling righteous, and if you have satisfied yourself that what I have told you is indeed hate speech, then what happens then? The next time that there is a jihad terror attack by somebody screaming Allahu Akbar, and somebody who has quotations from the Quran and on his Facebook page, and he has indicated that he is very pious. For example, the guy that tried to kill us in Texas when we held our free speech event there a couple years back, Ibrahim Simpson, he came from the mosque in Phoenix, drove all the way to Garland, Texas to get us. And one of his friends at the mosque said he practically lived here. He would sleep here. He never did anything that the mosque's leaders didn't want. So if all opposition to that is cleared away, then what happens the next time it goes on and people try to understand it and to deal with it in an effective way? Then there's nobody left to do that. There is no one who can analyze the problem effectively. The idea that this is all because of American political actions in the Middle East does not take into account the fact that the jihad is a lot older than the United States of America. And in the 7th century, when the invading armies conquered the Middle East and North Africa and amassed within 100 years an empire stretching from Spain to India, they were not reacting to the provocations of some superior power. They were the superior power. There were two great powers before the advent of Islam, the Byzantine Empire and the Persian Empire. But they were both exhausted. They had been fighting so many wars against each other that they didn't have enough troops anymore to withstand anything. The last battle that Muhammad fought wasn't really a battle at all, the Battle of Tabuk. When he went up to Tabuk in northern Arabia or southern Syria, depending on where you draw the border, and he was trying to attack the Byzantine garrison there, but there were no Byzantines. And there were no Byzantines because they didn't have enough troops to staff all their garrisons. So they would move from one to the other along the border lines. Well, that's obviously an empire ripe for collapse, and it did collapse. It lasted for several hundred more years, but in a vastly diminished form. The Persian Empire, same thing, was exhausted. These jihads were not the result of reaction to aggression by other powers. The other powers were not bothering the Arabs in Arabia. They couldn't possibly have done so if they wanted to. These jihads came about because of teachings of the Quran and teachings of Muhammad. I've been commanded to fight against people until they confess that there is no God but Allah and I am his messenger. Or the Quran chapter 8 verse 39, fight until religion is all for Allah. All these things have to be addressed by people of goodwill, Muslim and non-Muslim. And demonizing the people who ask the questions that need to be asked is counterproductive and ultimately only is going to serve to obscure the real problems that we have and make it impossible for us to address them. From 2005 to 2010, I regularly would instruct the FBI and military groups on Islam. I would give them an idea of the mindset of the terrorists. That's what it was all about. What do they think? Because it's an adage as old as warfare, you can't defeat an enemy you don't understand. So I take them through the Quran, take them through the life of Muhammad. In 2011, because Muslim groups complained, I was removed from this position, as were others, and all mention of Islam and jihad was taken out of counter-terror training. So now if you were to join the FBI tomorrow, you'll learn about right-wing extremists and militiamen and so on. You won't hear a word about Islam or jihad. It does not exist in the countering violent extremism program that Obama developed and that is still in place at this point. Now that is a recipe for disaster. You cannot defeat an enemy you don't understand. And Muslims who genuinely reject that understanding of Islam should have no problem standing with us and helping to fight against it. That's all this is about. That's all my work has been about all these years, and that is all that I am trying to do as I continue to write and speak. And thank you for hearing me out. If you have any questions, I will take them now.
Christians ought to be converted or killed. My biggest question for you is, why are we focusing solely on Islam, or why do you in particular, I suppose, focus solely on Islam when there are bad apples in every bunch, I suppose. The IRA caused terror in the UK for nearly a century, the Lord's Army in Africa. Why focus simply on Islam?
Well, you know, I went to my podiatrist the other day, and I said, why don't you deal with heart trouble? There's no monopoly on evil, and there's no claim on my part that only Muslims are terrorists or only the terrorists are Muslims. I don't know the Duck Dynasty guy. I doubt that he's a very influential leader, and I don't see 30,000 attacks by Christians screaming Jesus is Lord around the world since 9/11, but I do see 30,000 Islamic Jihad attacks. So certainly there are evil people in every group who do all sorts of evil things. But this is a problem that needs to be addressed. And a specialist in one problem is not denying that there are other problems.
Hi, yeah, I just wanted to clarify something in terms of the police. Your followers ready to shoot a protester. So I took as a necessary precaution. Then I refused. Then to keep order. So, I mean, I think it's huge that you really think that they're listening.
I'm trying to clarify something.
Thank you. I actually deny the charge. I don't think that my followers threatened to shoot anyone. There was a comment on the website, and you know, anybody can write comments, and I don't know who those people are. And I know from a great deal of experience that there are many, many people who try to discredit the site, who are actually on the other side of the perspective they are representing themselves to be. In any case, I don't approve of any such activity. I was certainly threatened, and that was quite clear. And I don't approve of any threats to you or to anybody else.